2005 was a landmark year for the PC. The first dual-core CPUs from both Intel and AMD rolled out, 64-bit Windows was freed from the chains of Itanium, PCI Express made its way into chipsets from every major vendor, and ATI and NVIDIA were trying to claw their way into as many of those PCIe slots as possible. In this debut episode of 1v1, we'll pit the two fastest GPUs of 2005 against each other and see which best stood the test of time, GeForce 7800 GTX 512 versus Radeon X1800 XT. Our story starts not with either of today's contenders, but a different 7800 GTX. The original 256MB GeForce 7 flagship launched in June of 2005 at an MSRP of $600. It was essentially last year's 6800 Ultra on steroids, featuring 8 extra more powerful pixel pipelines, 2 more vertex shaders, and a die shrink from 130 to 110 nanometer. What didn't change much were the clock speeds. The reference 7800 GTX was clocked just a hair higher than the 425MHz many 6800 Ultra shipped at, and only offered a 9% improvement to memory bandwidth. These conservative clocks meant that it could get away with using a single-slot cooler, something NVIDIA hadn't been able to do on a flagship card since the GeForce 4 series. They were sandbagging, as if to say, your move, ATI. The response from Team Red was, for the rest of the summer, nothing. ATI was too busy trying to figure out why their fancy 90nm R520 core kept randomly failing at the high clock speeds they knew they'd need to hit to compete. It wasn't until October that the X1000 series was ready for its reveal, and even then, the flagship X1800 XT would have to wait another month for general availability. NVIDIA, ever the party crasher, countered just 9 days later with a new ultra-high-end card, the GeForce 7800 GTX 512. Don't let the name fool you, this is more than a regular GTX with twice the VRAM. It used the same G70 core as the original, but with tweaked and binned dies allowing a 28% uplift to core clock, an even bigger jump in memory bandwidth, and in my opinion, the best looking reference cooler of all time. The design was lifted straight from the earlier Quadro FX4500, and its quad heat pipes still look somewhat modern nearly 20 years later. This card exists for only one reason: beat ATI no matter what. Availability was sparse at best thanks to the strict binning required, and the price was $50 higher than the original 7800 GTX, and $100 over the Radeon. At the time, X1800 XT was no match for this behemoth, but has the story changed in the years since? Before we find out, let's take a closer look at the specs, strengths, and weaknesses of each card. Both contenders are DirectX 9.0C and OpenGL 2.1 compliant, mostly, we'll get to that, and include 512MB of GDDR3 VRAM on a 256-bit bus. The 7800 GTX 512's RAM is clocked a bit higher, at 1.7 gigabit per second versus 1.5 on the X1800 XT. Thanks to ATI's node advantage, the Radeon enjoys a heady 625MHz core clock, up from the 550MHz NVIDIA had to cherry-pick dies to achieve. As both cards contain 8 vertex shaders and 16 ROPs, that gives the X1800 XT a 13.6% lead in geometry processing and pixel fill rate. These might seem like clear-cut advantages for the Radeon, but it's not that simple. The X1000 family is capable of applying MSAA to a floating point render target, while the GeForce 7 series isn't. In practical terms, this means the X1800 XT can run, say, Oblivion with HDR and AA at the same time, while the 7800 GTX 512 forces you to choose between them. On the other hand, the X1000 series doesn't support Vertex Texture Fetch, a feature of DirectX 9's Vertex Shader 3.0 standard. I'm no graphics programmer, but my neophyte understanding is that VTF allows the vertex shaders to read a texture directly from cache and perform calculations against it. In their marketing material for the GeForce 6 series, NVIDIA showed off fancy wave effects from the 2004 Flight Sim Pacific Fighters, and as you can see, they look great on the 7800 GTX. Switch to the X1800 XT and the depth is gone, replaced with a flat, choppy animation. ATI argued that implementing VTF properly would be prohibitively expensive and perform slowly, and instead create an alternative, render-to-vertex buffer. R2VB would use the two-pass approach, where you render out your texture and send it back up the pipeline to the vertex shader. As one developer put it, it was a hideous, makes-your-eyes-bleed sort of hack. It's really, really nasty. The two cards differ further in pixel shading and texturing. NVIDIA went all out for G70, with 24 pixel pipelines each capable of 16 flops per clock between its two main shader ALUs. That gave it a massive, for the time, 211 gigaflops of pixel shading power. ATI looks weak by comparison, with 16 pixel pipelines and 12 flops per clock each, for a total of 120 gigaflops. These numbers don't tell the whole story. G70's texture mapping units are attached to the first of each pipeline's two shader ALUs, and texture addressing operations prevent that ALU from doing any shading work. R520 has no such compromise. Each pipe gets its own TMU, which is why ATI was able to produce cores such as RV530 with 3 pixel shaders per pipeline. Both of these designs sat on the line between the 6th and 7th console generations. In the PlayStation 3's case, the GPU essentially is a 7800 GTX with relatively minor modifications. Contrary to popular belief, the Xbox 360 Xenos GPU is not derived from R520. It's more of a predecessor to Terascale, developed separately from ATI's desktop DX9 architectures. Every game in the test suite released right in the middle of the 7th Gen's lifespan, so you'll get as true a picture as I can paint of which card aged best. Today's test system is a Dell Vostro 230 with a Core 2 Quad Q9550S, 4GB of DDR3 1066, a 2TB hard drive, and Windows Vista SP2. Why Vista?
Because...
That's all you need to know right there!
For drivers, I'm using Catalyst 10.2 for the Radeon and 306.97 for the GeForce. I should mention that I'm cheating a bit with a 7800 GTX 512. Back in November, I picked up two untested cards after hearing other success stories. Both of them arrived artifacting. I wasn't about to waste even more money on another try, so I modified the VBIOS on a 7900 GTX to match the clock speeds of a 7800 GTX 512 and called it good. IXBT did some clock-for-clock testing in their 7900 GTX review and found there was, at most, a 5.5% advantage for the newer card in contemporary games. Considering the rarity of real, working 7800 GTX 512s, this is a compromise I'm happy to make. We'll start this showdown with a few synthetics. In 3D Mark 03, the GeForce pulls ahead by a 12% margin. The race is much closer in 3D Mark 05. Team Green still wins, but by less than 2.5% this time. 3D Mark 06 has the GeForce winning even harder, with nearly 15% more points than the Radeon. Neogen Sanctuary swings the opposite direction, with a similar 15% win going to the X1800 XT. The numbers don't tell the whole story for this one. The parallax mapping effect appears correct on the GeForce, but broken on the Radeon. I'm assuming this is due to the X1800 XT's lack of Vertex texture fetch support. Out of curiosity, I tested Sanctuary again with parallax maps disabled, and the Radeon's lead shrunk to just 7%. Because I'm feeling generous, I'll give Nvidia the point for rendering correctly with default settings. Moving on to games, we'll start with the oldest entry, Lost Planet Colonies. The first section of the built-in benchmark proved fairly demanding, even at 800x600. The average frame rate is basically a tie, but I'll give the GeForce the win thanks to its stronger 1% lows. Crisis Warhead ran noticeably faster on the X1800 XT to the tune of 24%. These settings do the game no justice, but I wanted to keep the lows up since this is a first-person shooter. Far Cry 2 is an even bigger dub for the Radeon, with a nigh on 30% boost to averages and even stronger 1% lows. Modern Warfare 2 bullies the 7800 GTX even harder. Team Red pulls out a huge 45% win here, though the difference in lows isn't quite so massive. I'm copying Notebook Check's test procedure, so these numbers represent nearly 5 minutes of the beginning of the game. Moving into the 2010s, Aliens vs. Predator turned out to be the hardest test in the suite, with mediocre frame times on the Radeon and outright awful stuttering on the GeForce, even at rock-bottom resolution. GTA 4's first expansion pack is a train wreck for the 7800 GTX. Shadows are rendered incorrectly beneath vehicles, so ATI gets an automatic win. Lara Croft and the Guardian of Light has enough headroom on both cards to enable 4X AA, and the performance is close enough to call a tie. It's worth mentioning that the Radeon, to my eyes at least, produces smoother edges versus the GeForce. There's also some nasty and consistent stutter at the beginning of the level on the 7800 GTX that doesn't happen on the X1800 XT, but since it's not part of the test scene, it doesn't count. Dawn of War 2's final expansion looks equally bad on both cards thanks to this in-your-face color banding you can see in the main menu. This can be circumvented by using a DX10 card with the high setting for post-processing, something you can't use on these DX9 cards. Good news for Nvidia, the GeForce pulls out a very strong win in this one. F1 2011 has the exact same banding on car tires, and the victory again goes to the X1800 XT for its much stronger lows. Last but not least, Todd Howard Simulator 5's opening kart ride might look like a win for the 7800 GTX, but look closer and you'll see the lighting isn't quite right. The whole scene swings between shadowed and bright, seemingly at random, while the X1800 XT looks like you'd expect. For this, and the healthier 0.1% lows, it's another point for Team Red. All told, the Radeon X1800 XT walks away with 8 points, and the GeForce 7800 GTX 512 with 7. That's an overly simplistic summary. Nvidia's wins tended to be less consequential, like in 3D Mark and Lost Planet, but its biggest losses are from the GeForce tripping over its own shoelaces in actual games. I can only assume the drivers are to blame, despite releasing well after everything in the test suite. The Radeon ran every game without any major errors, and a rendering issue with one effect in Neogen Sanctuary is something I can live with. The X1800 XT aged better, plain and simple. Is it a perfect card? No. The lack of true vertex texture fetch is a bummer, and the stock cooler is loud. Overall though, Team Red's 2005 Powerhouse is a much less compromised card than Team Green's, and I'm happy to declare it the winner of 1v1 Episode 1. If you want a more technical dive into the architectures behind these cards, I highly recommend checking out Pixelpipe's Card Battles video on the original 256MB 7800 GTX versus X1800 XT, linked in the description. Until next time, thank you for watching.